Donc, 12 cc égale... C'est combien j'avais? Oui. 18 minutes 54 secondes.
The Vanishing is ostensibly about two men, a man searching for his lost lover and the man who kidnapped her. But midway through, it becomes plain that the film is much more interested in the villain than in the hero. A good two-thirds of the film is spent charting his meticulous path towards murder. And while the hero's search is depicted as desperate, disorganized, and self-destructive, the villain's ritualistic preparations for his crime are filmed with a comparable attentiveness, approaching reverence for the subject.
Bum, bum, bum. Pardon?
The villain's procedures are part science project, part performance rehearsal. As such, it invokes strong ties to the art and craft of filmmaking, which may explain why director George Sleaser is so drawn to his subject, identifying as he does with relentless problem-solving, improvisation, learning from mistakes, and repeated takes before finally getting it right. But the question remains, for what purpose is all of this effort devoted? For the killer, it was simply to prove to himself what he was capable of doing, murder as ego fulfillment. What about for Sleaser? What informs his disproportionately intent focus on his anti-hero's steady path to homicidal achievement? Does it reflect a value system that places craft above all things, over morality, or even as something that transcends morality? One definition of art is to conceive of and to organize one's resources to achieve a reality that one cannot in real life. But it can also be to escape life. So is the obsession and ritual behavior that accompanies artistic creation then its own reward? Is this what they refer to in one episode of Seinfeld as being, quote, master of your domain? Around the time that I watched Vanishing, I also watched David Fincher's Zodiac, and I couldn't help but draw comparisons and contrasts. Both films are about serial killers, but whereas The Vanishing betrays a directorial prejudice towards the killer, the perspective of Zodiac is most squarely aligned with those dedicated to finding the elusive murderer. All of them, and David Fincher included, become consumed with the surfeit of materials through which they must sift to come to an answer, materials that are presented on screen in as many ways as they are analyzed in real life. As Nathan Lee points out in his review for The Voice, even the Zodiac letter gets a point of view shot. And the sequence, like this one with the taxi cab, betrays the notion of David Fincher as an Orson Welles in a candy store type director. A shot like this, with this ostentatiously precise geometry of movement, reflects the perspective of a fussy orchestrator, a child playing with a toy car set, or even God himself. Zodiac is a story that begins with a couple of heart-rending murder scenes that cry out for justice. But by the middle of the film, a narrative coup similar to what we see in The Vanishing takes place. Even though this film sides with the good guys, not the killer, it ends up being just as focused on process as a kind of satisfaction in itself. The subtitle for Nathan Lee's Village Voice review reads, David Fincher forgoes the personal for the process. But more accurately, in this film, the personal is the process.
This suspect is not your Zodiac.
The most interesting thing about Zodiac is that by the last act of the film, the central crisis no longer seems to be one of man bringing fellow man to justice, but of man's ability to sift through the infinite data that exists in the world and create order and meaning. It's the existentialism of work.
Hey, we found Linda. She's in jail, isn't that great?
And when is it gonna be finished? When you catch him? When you arrest him?
Be serious.
I am serious.
I need to know who he is. I need to stand there. I need to look him in the eye. And I need to know that it's him.
Is that more important than your family's safety?
Of course not.
It is no longer doing work for the world. Doing work is the world.
Why?
Because nobody else will.
That's not good enough.
Are you done? Can I go?
In real life, the Zodiac case has not yet been solved. The killer has not conclusively been identified.
Can I help you?
No.
But in a surprising shift for a film that's done its best to stick to the facts of the case, Fincher does not leave us with that impression.
Last time I saw this face was July 4th, 1969. I'm very sure that's the man who shot me. I'm very sure that's the man who shot me.
Maybe the Hollywood overseers needed some semblance of a happy ending, or the sense of inconclusiveness was too much to bear for a control freak like Fincher. Fincher has a hard time embracing the unresolved, and when he has to, he has to wrap it up in his terms, whether it's the chilling neatness of Seven or the fuck-it-all conclusion of Fight Club. For one who is obsessed with process and craft as Fincher, can't admit to the sobering conclusion that all this work, all this due diligence, may sometimes yield no results. Instead, he settles at the end for a much narrower maxim, that the dog who digs long enough and hard enough
gets the bone.